That's even better. Welcome back to the second plenary lecture of the afternoon. It's my pleasure to turn the podium over to my friend and colleague, Jane Gallop, to introduce Mary Ann Doane.
Hello. I want to welcome you all who aren't from UWM to Milwaukee, UWM, and the Center for 21st Century Studies. These days, here at C21, I am generally the person in the room who has been coming to center events for the longest. But in this case, I must cede that position to Mary Ann Doane, who actually got to the Center for 20th Century Studies conference a full year before I did. And there are not a lot of us around who were here in the 70s. I first came to the Center for 20th Century Studies in 1979, but Mary Ann, I have learned, was at International Film Conference 4 in March of 1978, which is 40 years ago. And so I say this all partly because this is our 50th anniversary celebration. So I want to mark that history. I requested Mary Ann's CV in order to prepare my introduction, and once it was on my computer, I searched the word Milwaukee in her CV, which was a very efficient way of getting some of what I want to talk to you about her as a start, as part of this 50th anniversary of the Center for 20th and 21st Century Studies. It turns out that before she got here today, Mary Ann spoke at 7 conferences at the Center for 20th and 21st Century Studies, 7. So she was, as I said, she was at the International Film Conference 4 in 1978, the International Film Conference 5 in 1979, and the International Film Conference 6 in 1980, which I believe is the first time I heard her speak, in March of 1980. She was then at the Conference on Independent Cinema in 1982, at the Television Conference in 1988, at the conference on called Knowing Mass Culture Mediating Knowledge in 1999, and most recently, and she teased me, I said that's the last time I saw you, in 2007 at the conference in terms of gender in 2007. And she teased me, I called that recently, it was 11 years ago. So I got to know Mary Ann Doane first in the context of UWM and the Center for 20th Century Studies. But I also encountered her some other places because at that time, back in the 1970s and early 80s, we were both working on feminism and psychoanalysis, although I was not working in film. Searching for Milwaukee on Mary Ann's CV, I also discovered that she published a paper in the Working Paper series at the Center for 20th Century Studies in fall 1984. There used to be a Working Papers. These were unpublished papers. It was a paper called When the Direction of the Force Acting on the Body Has Changed, the Moving Image. And it was published actually, in Wide Angle in 1985. But it was first published as the wrong word. It was first distributed. She generously offered it to the Center for 20th Century Studies so that we could have it as a working paper. And in the mid-80s, there were a lot of working papers from people who had spoken regularly at the Center for 20th Century Studies. So that's kind of, I wanted to start with what I could find out about the history of her relation to this institution that's sponsoring this conference. But obviously she's done a lot more than what she's done in Milwaukee. Mary Ann Doane is the class of 1937 professor of film and media at the University of California, Berkeley. And she was previously the George Hazard Crooker professor of modern culture and media at Brown University. She is the author of 3 major books, The Desire to Desire, the woman's film of the 1940s from 1987. Femme Fatale, Feminism, Film Theory, Psychoanalysis from 1991. And The Emergence of Cinematic Time, Modernity, Contingency, the Archive from 2002. And then, of course, as you probably all know, she's the author of dozens and dozens of articles. I'd like to cite just a few of the most influential. The Voice in the Cinema, The Articulation of Body and Space, published in Yale French Studies in 1980. Film in the Masquerade, Theorizing the Female Spectator, published in Screen, 1982. Technophilia, Technology, Representation, and the Feminine, in the volume Body Politics, Women and the Discourses of Science, from 1990. Information, Crisis, Catastrophe, published in the volume Logics of Television, a volume that comes out of the Center for 20th Century Studies, edited by Patricia Mellencamp for Indiana University Press in 1990. And finally, The Woman's Film, Possession and Address, published in the volume Revision, Essays in Feminist Film Criticism, edited by Marianne Doane, Patricia Mellencamp, and Linda Williams in 1984, which is another center-connected volume, I believe. And more recently, just a few more recent articles, Screening the Avant-Garde Face in the Question of Gender, Indiana University Press 2011, which is actually another center volume. Has Time Become Space? Thinking Media Aesthetics from 2013. Facing a Universal Language, New German Critique, 2014. The Cinematic Signifier and the Imaginary from Christian Metz and the Codes of Cinema, Film, Semiology, and Beyond from 2017. Apart from all of these conferences, papers, texts, Marianne and I have had a few run-ins around job applications, interviews, offers, and the like. And I want to tell you all that in these quite emotionally complicated professional interactions, I have never known a person so completely decent. Not only is Marianne Doane absolutely brilliant, but she stands out among all the academics I have known over four decades as one of the very most generous, decent, and honorable human beings. It is a great honor for me to introduce her to you here, even though I'm completely sure she needs no introduction.
Thank you very much, Jane, for that wonderful introduction. I don't really know what to say, but thank you anyway. I was going to come up here and say, before the end of your introduction, how old you made me feel, which is still true. I also did the search of Milwaukee on my CV, and I came up with the same thing you did. But I organized it. There were six in the when the center was the Center for 20th Century Studies, and only one, well now two, when the center was called the Center for 21st Century Studies. So I span centuries, which also makes me feel old. And I also believe, I may be wrong about this, that nobody who was here at Milwaukee when I came for my first conference in 1978, is still here. I know that Pat Mellencamp was here, Teresa De Laredes was here then. The first conference that I went to was also co-organized by Stephen Heath. So it's really impossible to overemphasize how formative the center, whether for 20th century studies or 21st century studies, has been. In my scholarly career. I have a little anecdote which I like to tell about the center. When I first went to Brown and I was a baby scholar, for some reason I was invited to a high-level meeting in the provost's office. I don't know why I was invited, probably as the token female at that time. Everybody else was probably about 30 years older than me. But we were talking, and I mentioned the Center for 20th Century Studies, and everyone broke out in laughter. And I couldn't really figure out until later why they were laughing, and it was that you cannot study the 20th century in the 20th century. So we've now moved on, and it's possible to study the 20th century, but sorry, no 21st century. So institutions persist, and I have to say I'm very happy to be here again. And I'd like to thank Richard for having invited me. And I'd also like to thank all of the graduate students who we know are the true infrastructure of all conferences. I don't think that conferences could be run without graduate students. So thank you very much. One last introductory remark about feeling old. This next to Andre Gaudreau's talk, this makes me feel very old-fashioned. I use the word cinema. So please, whenever I use it, think of it as being in quotes, or I like better the French, distanciating marks. And it goes back a little to the earliest cinema as well as to more recent cinema. Okay, so the title of the talk, as you can see, is How Big Should It Be? Scale, Screens, and the Ends of Cinema. And I start with a epigraph from Robert Smithson from Cinematic, an article called Cinematic Atopia, How Big Should It Be? The sights and films are not to be located or trusted, all is out of proportion, scale inflates or deflates into uneasy dimensions. We wander between the towering and the bottomless. We are lost between the abyss within us and the boundless horizons outside us. Any film wraps us in uncertainty. Let me know if you can't see the slides, and I can turn the lights down. Arguments about the end or death of cinema often circulate around the accelerating proliferation of different venues or platforms for the exhibition and reception of films. Films can now be viewed on phones, laptops, tablets, desktop computers, television screens, as well as in traditional or IMAX theaters. So it is not simply or primarily the loss of celluloid as material base and the perceived dematerialization of the digital that contribute to a nostalgia for a lost cinema, but also its delocalization or displacement from the theatrical sites that have been its historical support. Images are mobile and transportable, savable and recyclable, called up at will, and often ephemeral. The cinematic object is no longer site-specific, which contributes to the sense of its heavy physical being vanishing into a vaporous and elusive network for which the cloud, continually malleable, shape-shifting, evanescent, emerges as the perfect trope. 35mm films in cans, on reels, requiring projectors, transported on trucks, trains, or planes, are the bearers of a terrestrial weight that we barely remember. Films are now viewable on the smallest of screens as well as the largest. Although David Lynch, in defense of the large screen, has categorically insisted, using various expletives, that if you view a film on an iPhone, you simply haven't seen the film. And this is in an Apple commercial also. The mobility of images is a pervasive cultural phenomenon that must be confronted. Perhaps it is not so much a question of whether it is the same image, but how technologies with such extreme differences of scale can inhabit the same media network. What is the work of scale in contemporary media, and how does it configure or reconfigure space, location, and subjectivity? To understand this, I believe that we need to look again at the historical vicissitudes of scale in time-based media, particularly cinema, which has from the outset manipulated scale in its techniques and at the same time been haunted by the instabilities and precariousness of scale's relation to representation. The history of film theory is inundated with speculation about the effects of various scales of shots, but by far the most heavily discussed scale is that of the close-up. From Jean Epstein's Rapture when confronted with the magnification of the human face, to Béla Ballage and Gilles Deleuze's insistence that the close-up of the face absorbs all space within itself and no longer acts as metonymy, pointing to a larger whole, the close-up has been accompanied by an excessive discourse, or at the very least, a discourse of excess. It is as though scale had gone awry. In comparison, the medium shot and the long shot appear to be of normal scale. For Sergei Eisenstein, tearing the object from the real, the close-up introduced, quote, absolute changes in the dimensions of bodies and objects on the screen, unquote. The ordinary rules of classical perspective no longer obtain. Quote, the laws of cinematographic perspective are such that a cockroach filmed in close-up appears on the screen 100 times more formidable than 100 elephants in medium-long shot, unquote. Because the close-up exaggerates a perceived distortion of scale that in fact characterizes any projected image of film, it has been the subject of a film theoretical obsession. The close-up always carries the threat of a certain monstrosity, a face or object filling the screen and annihilating all sense of scale. In practice, cinema has always exploited the structuring ambiguity of shot size in the cinema, the ambiguity of scale versus distance. Despite the demand for life-size images of human beings in journalistic discourses about early cinema and a certain anxiety about cutting up the body, very early films often played intensively with the relations, contradictions, and potential misreadings of the interplay between scale and distance. In Georges Méliès' 1901 film, The Man with a Rubber Head, a chemist played by Méliès produces a close-up within the diegesis by placing his own head on a table and then pumping it with air. I'm going to show part of this film and an entire other short film, which I know that a lot of you have seen already, but I want to really discuss it in terms of scale and not other attributes, which are also important and interesting. I'm going to move a little forward. He's taken off his head and put it on the table. Can you see that okay? Okay, spoiler alert. He gets his assistant who also blows up the head but continues to blow it up until it explodes at the end. Méliès generated the illusion by superimposing in the open space under the arch a view of his enlarging head obtained by having the director roll on a trolley on an inclined plane toward the camera. The effect in the image is not that of a decreasing distance between the head and the camera spectator position, but that of a head growing larger and larger as it is pumped with air. The precariousness and instability of such a perversion of magnitude of bodily scale is underlined by the catastrophic explosion at the end. Méliès' play with scale, his ironic and hyperbolic exploitation of the larger-than-life quality of the cinema, is consistent with a more widespread interrogation of the aesthetic feasibility of the close-up in early cinema.
The specter of the close-up is raised whenever an object or person moves towards the camera, potentially putting into crisis the distance between screen and spectator, threatening to bridge the abyss of representation. Perhaps the most extreme of these early filmic ruminations on that threshold is The Big Swallow, aka Interviewee Swallows Camera by James Williamson in 1901.
The sales catalog gives a description of this film, which clarifies the action.
I won't. I'll eat the camera first.
A gentleman reading finds a camera feed with his head under a cloth, focusing him up. He orders him off, approaching nearer and nearer, gesticulating and ordering him off, until his head fills the picture. And finally, his mouth only occupies the screen.
The film dramatizes in raw form the implications of the extreme close-up, of occupying a space that is too proximate, a kind of no man's land of representation. For it is not only the cameraman who is incorporated and absorbed within the diegesis, but the figure of the spectator as well, who succumbs, if only momentarily, to the enveloping nothingness of the screen. There is an ironic play here on the inextricability of proximity and size in relation to the camera. The gentleman has only to move closer to the camera to become large enough to swallow it. These two films signify, by putting into play and exploiting, the cinema's ability to shatter conventional scale, its tendency to produce, or in these instances, to thrive on, disorientation and dislocation, to construct a space and a world to its own measure. In these examples, the problematic of scale and its distortion in cinema is performed. This distortion is not limited to the close-up, which is perhaps its best example, but is endemic to every shot size. With the rise of the classical Hollywood narrative and its continuity editing, the spectator was positioned to be less aware of the ambiguity. Preserving the unity and homogeneity of space, this style transmuted the perception of scale, that is, calling attention to the size of the screen, that of the image, and aspect ratio, or representational space, into the perception of distance within the diegesis, represented space. This technique affects a displacement or amelioration of the threat of large scale, disproportion, and a disturbing monumentality by translating scale, that is the logic of large and small, into distance, closer or further. The word and the concept of scale, however, have many different meanings. In geometry, scale is a relatively straightforward concept linked to proportion. Scale refers to the relation between the representation of an object or a territory on a map and the object itself. In the Oxford English Dictionary, scale is a, quote, system of representing or reproducing objects in a smaller or larger size proportionately in every part, to scale with exactly proportional representation of each part of the model. That's the definition of to scale. But the term can also refer to a range of exposures or colors in photography or of notes in music. Scale is in addition a standard of measure or calculation, as on a global scale or the scale of the catastrophe. In the plural, it can be an attribute of the body, quote, membranous or horny outgrowths or modifications of the skin in many fishes and reptiles and some mammals, unquote. or as a disease, one of the layers of the epidermis which can become separated. In another somewhat remote sense, scales can be a cause of blindness or lack of knowledge, as in to remove the scales from one's eyes, which means to become enlightened and binds knowledge to the visible. Scale is also a measure of weight, as in the scales of justice, although here the judge is blindfolded, one of the most potent symbols of democracies. While scale might be assumed to be an extremely stable concept within the discipline of geography, the scale of mountains, valleys, urban areas, etc., in recent years there have been raging debates about the concept of scale in human geography, cultural geography, and radical geography. The project of geographers has aimed at the deontologization of scale and its understanding as a social and hence variable construction. Although there is widespread acceptance of a methodological division between the local, the urban, the regional, the nation state, and the global, the relations between these scales and sometimes the usefulness of the divisions themselves is subject to great dispute. Are these relations nesting, hierarchical, dialectical? Andrew Kirby echoes David Harvey in claiming that globalization is a concept displacing the more politically charged concepts of imperialism and neocolonialism. Marxist radical geographers tend to see capitalism as the driver of scale and through accumulation fostering a greater and greater expansion. Feminist geographers often claim that the emphasis upon production has suppressed an understanding of the scale of realms of reproduction and the domestic, usually associated with women. Taken further, this position claims that the global over-local hierarchy, quote, underwrites the problematic view that social processes can be detached from the grounded sites where people and objects concretely reside and social practices take place, for example, in streets, bedrooms, and boardrooms, unquote. Larger scales, the nation state, the global, this is again from the feminist point of view, in their absolute abstraction should be dismissed in favor of human experiential scales. This in turn poses a number of problems linked to the polarization of the abstract and the concrete. Assuming, for instance, that nationalism or globalism are not lived or do not have very real effects, and that the experiential is not infused with abstraction. But this is a recurring problem in discourses about scale that almost always calibrate themselves in relation to a particular conceptualization of the human. In Robert Taverner's vast intellectual history of the various systems of measurement devised by cultures over the last two millennia, called Smoot's Ear, the Measure of Humanity, the practice of calculating size in relation to the human body as ultimate standard in the foot, the cubit, etc., is displaced historically by the search for a universal system ultimately based on the abstract and dehumanized, if not anti-human, meter. For Taverner, this development constitutes a great loss, a denial of human experience or human scale, both determined by the body. Hence, the narrative of Oliver R. Smoot acts as not simply an amusing anecdote, but as a hyperbolic confirmation of Taverner's call for a greater humanization of scale. Smoot, the shortest initiate in a fraternity at the Massachusetts Institute of Technology in 1958, was chosen as the subject and tool of a prank revolving around measurement. The initiates, or pledges, were given the task of measuring the length of the Harvard Bridge using Smoot's height as the determinant unit. He was 5'7", in case you're curious. They found that the bridge was 364.4 smoots, plus or minus one ear. That's smoot being used to measure the bridge. And here is Smoot's ear. Here, the body is quite literally used as a form of measurement. For Taverner, Smoot's ear represents the leftover, the plus or minus, the inevitable impossibility of truly accurate measurement, and hence the confirmation of the persistence of the human, here encapsulated as the fallible in all measuring systems. In addition, the humor of the prank hinges on the knowledge that Smoot's height has no generalizability, but is one of the specific features of individuality, given the very large range of human sizes. The MIT prank is an ironic conflation of the scientistic and the humanistic. And yet scale is associated with the corporeal in another way, as the flakes or laminates of skin that can be peeled away as traces of the body lost to the body, a pathological phenomenon. In this sense, scale is entangled with the vision of mechanical reproduction as a peeling off and circulation of the forms or skins of bodies or objects. In the June 1859 issue of the Atlantic Monthly, Oliver Wendell Holmes wrote that photography, and specifically stereography, divorced form from matter and hence deprived matter of the value of its visuality. Quote, there is only one Colosseum or Pantheon, but how many millions of potential negatives have they shed, representatives of billions of pictures since they were erected? Every conceivable object of nature and art will soon scale off its surface for us. Men will hunt all curious, beautiful, grand objects as they hunt the cattle in South America for their skins and leave the carcasses as of little worth, unquote. Holmes was concerned with the impact of this for the archive, how to store and make accessible the resulting huge numbers of scales or skins of objects. But the detachability of these forms in photography and their later projection in the cinema also dissolved any concept of scale that could be soldered to the spectator's body, occasioning an anxiety that manifested itself in the early cinema as a demand for life-size images in early press commentary on moving pictures. The close-up in particular was perceived as aesthetically offensive in extreme ways, as monstrous or grotesque, even castrating, an excessive display of disproportion in scale and a violence to the human body. The residue of this hysteria can be seen in the hyperbolic language of early film theorists such as Jean Epstein and Bela Balazs. The continuing and compensatory effects of this anxiety about representation and scale can still be seen in the concept of actual size or actual scale, often used in advertising photographs. It was actually very hard to find images of actual scale. And you can see that, you know, when they're digital, it's all is lost, basically. Actual scale is a paradox insofar as it is an attempt to annihilate representation, to authenticate the image by denying its scalelessness. Yet it is an admission of the scalar instabilities of visual representation. For like television and liveness, where the graphic live is required to authenticate the temporality of the image, one always has to be told with a caption that this is the actual scale of an object. And here is an internet image disproving the idea that that really is actual scale of the pill, the ibuprofen. There is an exception whose exceptionality is a function of its indexicality, its physical adherence to its object, the nature print, a physical imprint of a plant specimen, which Jeremy Blatter has named the, quote, 0 degree of scale, unquote. However, as he points out, the scalar fidelity sacrifices other attributes of the object, including its three-dimensionality. The cinema, even in films like Monray's Rheograms, in which pins and nails are scattered across the surface of the celluloid to exploit their direct imprint, has no access to this zero degree of scale because the images are projected on a screen and hence enlarged, unpredictably given the variation in theatrical throws. The concept of actual size, or the zero degree of scale, is hyperbolized and ironized in Jorge Luis Borges' famous short essay of exactitude in science. Jean Baudrillard's well-known reading of this essay emphasizes the ludic nature of a map the size of the territory it maps, and deploys Borges' essay to shed light on his own concept of simulation and the destruction of the real. But what is lost in his reading is Borges' ironic critique of science and his invention of a mythical cartography as an absurd instantiation of scientific exactitude. In that empire, the craft of cartography attained such perfection that the map of a single province covered the space of an entire city, and the map of the empire itself an entire province. In the course of time, these extensive maps were found somehow wanting, and so the College of Cartographers evolved a map of the empire that was of the same scale as the empire and that coincided with it point for point. Less attentive to the study of cartography, succeeding generations came to judge a map of such magnitude cumbersome, and not without irreverence, they abandoned it to the rigors of sun and rain. In the western deserts, tattered fragments of the map are still to be found, sheltering an occasional beast or beggar. In the whole nation, no other relic is left of the discipline of geography. And this is from Travels of Praiseworthy Men, which is, it appears in a collection of Borges' short essays entitled A Universal History of Infamy. And it takes the form of a literary forgery, which is attributed to J.A. Suarez Miranda and allegedly written centuries ago. The appeal to historicity is redoubled by the inconsistent use of capital letters as signs of an aged and historical writing. The historical loss emerges as that of the discipline of geography, whose tool, cartography, has evolved from a craft to a college, study, and finally a discipline. Why do we find this characterization of cartography and the ideal map so absurd? Maps are supposed to be utilitarian, and their utility hinges upon their reduced scale and hence portability. A map usually carries within it its own explanation of the scale it uses, for example, 1 inch equals 5 miles. But here, the perfection of cartography entails its own annihilation. The erasure of proportion as an instrument of representation, the very rejection of representation so that the map merges with its territory. Scientific exactitude avoids the possibility of inaccuracy by invoking a scale of 1-to-1 or point-to-point. Nostalgia for the discipline of geography is here nostalgia for the scale of the real. The cinema is the antithesis of this Borgesian perfect cartography. The cinema in its earliest years had barely started to generate a hysteria about scale deviating from the scale of the human body when it began to exploit the scalar instabilities of the projected image through the use of the scale model, one of the first special effects. In 1898, E.H. Lumet used miniature ships in a tank to film Battle of Santiago Bay. And Fred Dobson used a scale model of San Francisco burning in order to film the earthquake of 1906. The use of the scale model takes advantage of the illegibility of scale in the cinema, the spectator's inability to locate herself spatially in relation to the image. The comparability required to acquire a sense of scale resides only within the image, where perspective and distance can be manufactured independently of any, quote, real space. And these are just examples of the scale model, which you can only tell because they have human beings
And this is the shot from the, a shot from the Fifth Element based on a scale model. Robert Smithson's sense of dislocation in the cinema, a proportion out of control, leads him to label the cinema an atopia, no place. The scale model depends upon and instantiates what could be seen as two not unrelated failures of the classical theatrical cinema. First, the inability of the spectator to orient herself or to measure scale in relation to her own body, thus producing a fundamental dislocation. And second, the failure of the cinema to provide the precision and control of a scientific instrument due to its scalar instability, both spatially and temporally. This was Jules Etienne Marais' reason for dismissing film as a viable tool of scientific method. There is a sense in which cinema exposes the impossibilities of scale as it has been conceived in relation to both the realm of the human and the realm of abstract science. The scale model deployed in the early years of cinema can be linked to a long history of magic and illusion, including Etienne Gaspar Robertson's Phantasmagoria of the 1790s, based on the magic lantern, but distinguished from it by the concealing of both lantern and screen, so that the dark space of the auditorium was illegible to and unnavigable by the audience, making them vulnerable to the fear and anxiety of ghost-like apparitions. In the 19th century, the very popular Pepper's Ghost used a partially reflective mirror to produce the illusion of a bodiless actor or ghost, the mirror image, on the stage, again concealing the means of production. In the European film industry in the mid-1920s, Eugen Schuften invented a process using mirrors to generate illusory scales that came to be known as the widely used Schuften process. As Katerina Lowe has argued, the Schuften process standardized and commodified the bricoleur-like production of special effects that had previously been associated with art and handicraft in relation to singular filmic challenges that demanded varying approaches. The Schuften process was economical, allowing the extensive use of small scale models in place of large, expensive sets. Okay, this is the Schuften process. And in this process, a mirror, part of whose reflective surface has been removed, is placed at a 45 degree angle in front of the camera, and the small scale model is situated to the side of the camera. The live action of the scene appears in the non-reflective part of the mirror. This is the live action. Seemingly surrounded by the environment provided by the model, reflected in the mirror. The Schuften, and this is the final image. The Schuften process was used in two of Fritz Lang's films, Die Nibelungen, Siegfried, 1924, and Metropolis, 1927. And this is an example of a shot from Metropolis that was made with the Schuften process. As Lowe points out, the Schuften process was associated with Gulliver effects, i.e., quote, the rendition of extreme size differences between living things, unquote. Special effects in this case are based on the meticulous confusion of virtual and real images in order to produce effects of scale. The use of scale models contributes to the growing dissociation of scale and the human body, here the body of the spectator as measure. The critique of the abstract metric scale in evidence in Taverner's work was shared by Le Corbusier, who conceived of architecture first and foremost as a space designed for the human body, one which humans must inhabit, and therefore one whose proportions must accommodate that body. In the 1942 treatise, The Modulor, he embraced units of measure based on parts of the human body: the elbow, cubit, finger, digit, thumb, inch, foot, pace, etc.,
and disdained the move to the metric system, which was abstract and, quote, indifferent to the stature of man, unquote. These organic units were superior to the metric units because, quote, they formed an integral part of the human body, and for that reason, they were fit to serve as measures for the huts, the houses, and the temples that had to be built. More than that, they were infinitely rich and subtle because they formed part of the mathematics of the human body, gracious, elegant, and firm, the source of that harmony which moves us, unquote. Despite the nostalgia for man, not woman, as the measure of all things, the anthropometric system was certainly not unproblematic. It evinces a desire to naturalize and ground the concept of scale, to repudiate its resolute denial of an absolute and its consequent embeddedness in the process of comparison. And as Christopher Luckenbill has argued, quote, anthropometric measures are attributes of power and class struggle. They are symbolic and built on the process of social conditions in which the idea of just measures becomes a symbol of just man, of justice as such, and of just human relations, unquote. Hence the scales in the figure of a blind justice. While the development of the metric system was allegedly an attempt to produce and enforce a universal mode of measurement grounded in scientific principles, it simply incarnated a shift from the human body as regulator of scale to a globe that had become ever more definitive of experience, whose symbolic pressure was increasingly felt. In the late 18th century, well into the era of colonialism, there were two schools of thought about the definition of a standard unit of measurement, one based on the duration of the swing of a pendulum, which was ultimately rejected due to perturbations caused by gravity, and the other advocating the definition of the meter as 1/10,000,000th of the length of the distance from the equator to the North Pole. The approach based on the measurement of the circumference of the Earth was the historical victor, at least temporarily. In 1889, the first General Conference of Weights and Measures established an international prototype meter bar, which is still housed in Sèvres, France. Here you can honor the meter. Its original ground of authority was the measurement of the globe, an enterprise that was increasingly perceived as problematic since the Earth is not a perfect sphere. The globe, according to Peter Sloterdijk, has constituted the imaginary image of location, at least from the time of the circumnavigation of the world in the 16th century, and is hence a product of the colonial enterprise. Quote, discovery aims for acquisition. This gave cartography its world historical function. Maps are the universal instrument for securing what has been discovered, insofar as it is meant to be recorded on the globe and given as secure find, unquote. Contemporary discourses of globalization as a new phenomenon are blind to the fact that the concept of space in relation to a world conceived as a sphere and hence as conquerable are effectively much older than these discourses admit. The apprehension of the world as a globe coincided with the concept of discovery and control of new territory within colonialist and imperialist discourses. From the outset, globalization presupposed that any point on the globe was equidistant from the center, and hence in terms of measurement, at any rate, equivalent to any other location. A homogenization of space that continued to accelerate into the 20th century and beyond. The cinema participated in this early discourse of globalization in a number of different ways. It is not coincidental that the prototype meter bar came to incarnate a universal measurement at the same time that the cinema emerged with the claim that it was a universal language, readable across national and linguistic borders. The insistence of the globe as trope in the cinematic imaginary can be seen from advertisements in early film magazines. This is the name of the film magazine, and an advertisement for Great Northern Films, to the logos of film studios. Okay. RKO, which you just have the top of the globe, and better still, Universal. This is a video of the history of Universal logos, which was made on the 100th anniversary of Universal Studios. The cinema was an arena for a certain play with scale, an alignment of scales of shots that produced an imaginary space in which the idea of the spectator's location was repressed and reconfigured. The iconography of cinema often colluded with this discourse on scale and its malleability. Scale models go hand in hand with tales of enormous scalar disproportion between monsters and human beings. Monsters whose spectacular size is often a result of world disaster, of atomic catastrophe, whose effects are perceived in relation to seemingly unimaginable sizes, both small and large. Mothra, in the 1961 film of that title, produced by Toho Studios, is a gigantic egg, then caterpillar, then moth, whose disproportion is directly linked to atomic testing on the island where she resides. We don't need that one again. This is Mothra. And Mothra down to size, and Mothra as moth. The island in general is inhabited by fantastic forms of both plants and animals, and two women only 12 inches tall who act as Mothra's priestesses and are able to summon her after they are captured to be put on display in Japan. And he is there, of course, to demonstrate that they really are that small. As miniatures, they are carnival-like attractions who prove to be the fascinating scalar counterpart of the enormous Mothra. Godzilla, in the original film of that name, made by Ishiro Honda in 1954, is both a metaphor for and a product of nuclear holocaust. In his immensity and unstoppability, Godzilla is the atomic bomb itself. Honda, the director, said years after the film, quote, "I wanted to make radiation visible," unquote. For the threat of the atom bomb lies not so much in its materiality or even tremendous energy, but in the devastation of its lasting effects. A prominent paleontologist in the film inspects a giant radioactive footprint and hypothesizes that Godzilla is a creature from the Jurassic Age whose dormancy was broken by American testing of the H-bomb. Godzilla breathes radioactive fire. Unable to afford the stop-motion techniques of King Kong, Toho Studios borrowed from traditional kabuki and bunraku drama and portrayed Godzilla by having an actor wear a latex costume. The scale of the miniature sets was 1 to 25 to 1 to 50, the logic being that Godzilla must be able to see over what were the largest buildings in Tokyo at that time. In films of the ensuing series, Godzilla was rescaled to keep pace with the new skyscrapers of Tokyo. Godzilla's size is directly linked to visibility and invisibility. Gareth Edwards made his 2014 Godzilla larger than any previous incarnation. He was 350 feet high. In order to make, quote, the monster so big as to be seen from anywhere in the city, but not too big that he couldn't be obscured, unquote, allowing the capitalization of fear and anxiety associated with invisibility in the classic horror film. Giganticism of this genre, including Godzilla, Mothra, and King Kong, is accompanied by a number of tropes. The utter destruction of urban architecture, bridges, skyscrapers, etc. The ineffectivity of armies, missile systems, or any known defensive weapons in battling the monster. The awakening of a contained monster often associated with a primitive culture, and the resulting havoc it wreaks upon civilized societies. The tropes of discovery and conquest are pervasive. King Kong is discovered by a film crew and stolen from his primitive and even prehistorical surroundings in order to be put on display in New York. Here you have blackness confronting white femininity. The Empire State Building, because its scale is widely known, can ironically act as the measure of both empire and its conquest, King Kong. These pathologies of scale accompany the aggressive incursion or penetration into new spaces on the globe. The proof of this exploration of the new, the other, the alien, is the creature whose scale is unimaginable, inhuman. For Sloterdijk, the globe became, quote, the central medium of the new homogenizing approach to location, unquote. And its, quote, monopoly on complete views of the Earth's surface was only broken late in the 20th century by satellite photography. A sense of the world as globe ruptured the experience of location as potentially separate, isolated, protected. No place was immune from the knowledge that there was more outside, that one is caught within a global network. Location for Sloterdijk is, quote, not a blind spot in a field, but rather a place in which one sees that one is seen, unquote, as a consequence of globalization. In this sense, cinema is compensatory, for in the theater, the spectator sees that she is not seen. The credibility of the film's space depends upon it. The delocalization of the spectator, not necessarily her disembodiment, is the precondition for the intense production of location that is a crucial component of cinema. It is strange that film theory historically has not been more attentive to scale. It is a crucial component of the cinema's representation of space in a quite specific way that cannot be duplicated in theater or literature, the usual arts invoked in early discussions of cinematic specificity. While the scale model is perhaps the most overt and obvious incarnation of the cinema's ability to exploit the illegibility of scale, that tendency can be seen in the less ostentatious realms of the scale of shots. Close-up, medium shot, long shot, the aspect ratio and scale of the screen, perspectival relations, and the very fact of projection. A small frame becomes a dauntingly large projected image. The management of scale in the cinema is a fundamental aspect of its production of a space that resides nowhere else but in the cinema, hence its characterization as atopia. A space that could perhaps be characterized as both unreadable and overly readable, illusorily navigable and fundamentally disorienting. Today, the gigantic screens of IMAX theaters and sound surround systems, such as Dolby Atmos, work to reassert, to reconfirm the possibility of immersion in a manufactured space, which has played such an important role in the history of cinema. But here, it is space that is extended into the previously demarcated empty space of the spectators. In other words, it seems necessary today to exaggerate, to hyperbolize, to extend the cinema in order to be assured that it works. Yet the possibility of its failure is also allayed by the proliferation of miniature screens, so that it could be said that the screen is not simply enormous, it is everywhere. The inevitable limit to its magnitude is compensated for by its proliferation. Early films, early film theory, and the practice of the scale model elaborated the way in which detail and enormity, miniature and gigantic, are inextricable in the cinema. It is the cinema understood in this way which laid the groundwork for a future cultural logic of the screen. Thank you.
Thank you for a fantastic and intellectually challenging presentation. Without getting too deeply into the close reading of one of my favorite films of all time, King Kong, my mother used to let me stay home if it was on as a child. I'd like to ask you about the effects of the close-ups of Kong in that film, which seem to be resonating with the development of the close-up per se over the previous 20 years in stardom and glamour and empathy. Aren't we drawn in those scenes towards an empathy for him and the naturalness that's being destroyed by civilization? So that's like one question. And also, isn't the conquest of Kong by scale by the time that the film is over quite different than what happens with other monsters in the future? I mean, he's overwhelmed by the city, and even when he knocks down the L train and climbs, it seems like it's actually the scale of modernity that wins, not the scale of the monster.
The second one first, I don't think that's true. I think that these monsters, even if they're subdued, or in the case of Mothra, sort of lured to go back home again and leave, they wreak havoc on the cities. And I think that's part of what's at stake, is the impotence of human beings and their scale in the face of this incredibly large monster. You can see it even more, I think, in the 2007 version of King Kong, which I just taught, and I made my students watch it on their phones. and this goes to your first question about the close-up, I think, which is that in this earliest version of King Kong, there really aren't that many close-ups. In the 2007 version, there are some really good close-ups, particularly of the eyes of King Kong. Often these close shots are of his hand when he's holding the white woman, right? So that you get a sense of the scale there, you know, despite the close-up, which could actually humanize him. And I think in the 2007 version, there's much more of an attempt to humanize the relationship, to explain or rationalize the relationship between Anne and King Kong. She actually, in a way, seduces him. That's not really there in the earlier version, where the scream is the most important relationship to King Kong, and kind of articulates with the scream in general in the horror film, The Scream of the Woman. But I don't think close-ups are very important in any of these films. I'd have to go back and count, but I'm pretty sure that mostly they are characterized by shots that establish scale, that long shots. And one of the problems with the close-up is that it really doesn't do that, generally. As the early film theorists like Balazs and Epstein argued, the close-up kind of despatializes whatever it shows. It removes it from the context, completely despatializing it. And to some extent, I think that is definitely the case, and it reduces the ability, you know, to manufacture a sense of scale. So there's a film which I also showed recently, whose name I'm forgetting, but I'm sure somebody remembers it. It's the insect realm. What is it?
Microcosmos?
Yes, Microcosmos. And Microcosmos is a film that is almost entirely huge close-ups of insects, so that they seem to be, in a way, monstrous. And the film, but the film has to continually remind us of that fact. If it were simply close-ups, they would be reduced in scale. Instead, it goes back to long shots of where they reside, the meadow, the trees, et cetera. Periodically, it goes back. And I think that's important, an important kind of demonstration of the work and the vulnerability of the close-up in terms of scale.
Kirsten, then Doran, and then let's try to keep the questions short.
Okay. I wondered if you had thought about the role of the bubble here. You talk about the sphere and the figure of the earth, and obviously Sloterdijk himself has written about the bubble, because in visual culture, Plateau in particular is examining the bubble as a microcosm for larger physical structures, and that predates cinema, but I think cinema is definitely taking up these relational structures. You began your talk by talking about how we've shifted to the digital, so cinema has lost its weight and moved to a kind of a weightlessness, so thinking with the bubble rather than the planet. And also thinking about things like 360-degree filmmaking, where we've gone from a frame to an immersive bubble space of looking. Where is weight and breath and the body in relation to scale and the abstractions?
Can we collect the questions?
Sure.
Can you answer
that?
So Zoran, just
to try to... Oh, you just want me to ask my question? Go ahead. Oh, this was great. It was sort of touching upon many things I've been dealing with this semester. So just quickly, I mean, you mentioned David Lynch. I've been spending several weeks in Inland Empire with students, and one thing they really hated about the film, some of them, was how close we would get to character faces with the smaller cameras. So I was curious about what the sort of new digital technology, sort of shooting on iPhone or small portable digital cameras, are sort of speculative question, what they will do to our, the further sense of the close-up as sort of despatializing us in sort of kind of reality in the film.
My question is actually very similar. Thank you for a wonderful talk, by the way. So my question builds on your observations about the most recent remake of Godzilla, and I started thinking about Cloverfield and the way in which the size of the handheld camera in that giant monster disaster movie offers us a different kind of post-human scale. So that's another way, perhaps, of building on your question.
Okay, I can answer that pretty quickly. I'm afraid I haven't seen the film. I haven't seen Cloverfield, so I can't really answer the question. It's one of the many absences in my viewing experience, but I will definitely look at it, you know, soon in relation to your question. And let me go back to Kirsten's question. That's a really great question about the bubble and the use of the bubble and the relation of the weightlessness of film to the bubble as microcosm. And I really haven't finished thinking about, you know, Sloterdijk's relation to all of these issues about scale and size. As far as 360-degree videos and probably even more VR in terms of immersion and even things like IMAX, I think that I have an entire theory about this, which I won't go into, but it has more to do with, less to do with a kind of microcosm than it has to do with the attempt to destroy the frame. So IMAX is, Cinerama is first in that, in trying to get rid of your peripheral vision of the frame. And then IMAX, of course, trying to completely get rid of your peripheral vision so that you, and of course the term immersion is used consistently in advertising for IMAX and for VR, for that matter. I think that the concept of immersion is a very interesting one, and it really has to be deconstructed in a sense because, you know, what is it telling us about location? I think what's at stake is the location of the spectator, and that there's more and more of a tendency to delocalize the spectator, to basically make claims that you are not where you are and you are in another place, which is basically what VR does. And the question then is why? You know, why is there this tendency? Excuse me, I think in part, what I'm interested in about the phone, I guess to respond to your question, is not so much the close-up. Actually, my biggest interest in phones is using them as GPS. In other words, using them in order to locate where you are in relation to where you're going, etc. I think that that's the part or the use of the iPhone that articulates most with these other larger technologies of scale, that it has to do with location, localizability, etc. And I have various theories about the ideological import of that, but I won't go into those now.
Other questions? Anybody else? Last call.
Yeah, thank you. Yeah, that was really interesting. I'm trying to think about the notion of scale dimension, which is a great framework, I think, to approach a number of things. I'm trying to think about the scale in relation to point of view, to the figure of point of view, and I'm thinking if, as you said, the scale is somehow measuring the distance between the screen and the spectator, if it is possible to see point of view, the figure of point of view, the aesthetic figure, cinematic figure of point of view as the zero degree of scale. I mean, in a way, when the close-up gets too close, then it turns into the point of view, it turns into the figure where the spectator gets sucked up into the screen and feels embodied into the image, the POV as the figure where the actor moves, or the camera moves within a space, and the spectator feels embodied in the space. And as a footnote of that, usually close-ups in editing language are followed by point of view images. I mean, we see the close-up of a face, and then we cut, and we have the image of what the face is looking at. So this is relevant for me because I'm trying to build the theory of point of view as the inner engine of cinema, and I wonder if you feel talking about that.
That's a really interesting question because when you think about point of view is tied to the body in a way that no other kind of shot is. Your point of view in the audience is shared with the character, and it's the character's point of view that's being represented, and it's the body of the character that's at stake. And it reminds me of a wonderful article by Pascal Bonitzer about the labyrinth in cinema, in which he talks about the failure of a film called Lady in the Lake in the 40s, because, I'm sure you know this, yeah. And the reason that the film failed, according to him, is the impossibility of the body, of tying an entire film to a point of view shot that is tied to the body and therefore really can't change its scale in a sense. and that is encumbered so that when the character goes into a taxi, the camera has to go into the taxi, etc. And so it really destabilizes the whole, the goal or the function of cinema, which is to play with different scales. And it also is a way of linking scale again to the body. Because in a point of view shot, you know, you really don't have the ability to play with scale and to range over medium shot, long shot, close up, etc. And it simply points that film. I don't know if this is why it failed, but it points to the necessity of that in the classical narrative.
So I'm interested in the theory of the iPhone, and I think I will ask Marianne about that over a drink. So before we give her a round of applause, let me just remind you, if you haven't seen, that the schedule has changed slightly, both for some of the breakout panels and for one of the plenaries. So if you're waiting to see Caitlin, Benson, and Alan on Saturday afternoon, you better get here tomorrow morning, because we replaced Jean Ma, who unfortunately has the flu. And we'll be using that final session then as a wrap-up session where we can bring all these questions back to the table. So please join me in